Hello, coffee drinkers. Fender bass time, Logic session. Super streamlined here because I'm just going straight into the studio monitors. No amp setup, no pedals, nothing. Just straight quarter inch cable into the little mixing desk and in to the studio monitors. I'm getting ready for a recording session and a video shoot tomorrow morning, but really I'm concentrating on the audio element of it right now and how I prepare for that. The session is for my buddy Ryan, who owns and runs and created the Loop Loft, which is an awesome resource for drum loops and for composition and for scoring, for all kinds of things, for practicing. I use so many of these loops for practicing and for just jamming along to. I talked the other day a little bit about how I was going into Apple Loops and just grabbing a track and jamming along to it, how I had kind of progressed from jamming along to records and then taking a little segment of a bass line that I transcribed, then jamming along to a drum loop with no harmony involved so I could move it around the instrument. And now tomorrow we're doing a little video for Ryan, which kind of highlights how important it is to play with great musicians and musicians with great time and feel and kind of originality. You know, I picked out two tracks. Ryan sent me a bunch of stuff, Matt Chamberlain and Mark Juliana and all kinds of stuff. Out of all the tracks, the two I really gravitated towards was one by Nate Smith, which is this super cool kind of pop pocket groove, and the thing you just heard me playing over, which is Omar Hakim with this groove in three. So I get to do a session with Omar Hakim and Nate Smith tomorrow, virtually, of course. I don't think I've even met either of those guys. I've certainly never played with them, but through the wonders of modern technology and, you know, what the Loop Loft provide, and this is by no means a paid commercial for Ryan's product. I just happen to kind of dig it, and I do have bass loops there as well that I've done for him. I just think it's a cool concept, and it very much in line with the way I practice, exactly like the videos I've been making this week. And that's kind of what we're hoping to capture tomorrow in this session, is that importance of practice and how, you know, like I've been saying for the past few days over these groove videos, it's not always possible to have your favorite drummers in your apartment, especially not this tiny our studio apartment in the middle of a big city with neighbors everywhere. It's bad enough that it's like almost 11 o'clock at night and I'm playing as loud as I am, but I'm out of here in 2.5 weeks. So I'm kind of pushing the envelope a little bit as I go out of this place. But important to prepare, that's kind of the theme of today's vlog, is how I love to prepare for sessions. And I want to keep it really simple. I love this groove that I'm playing along to. No idea why I picked E flat minor, kind of E flat minor going to a D flat. But simple, right? It's just that was kind of how I would approach it if I was practicing, or if that was the kind of the verse of the song. If it just said E flat minor and D flat on a kind of lead sheet that somebody had given me, or that's what the song was, maybe I would approach it like that as simply as possible. And that's exactly how I like to make my preparations for a recording session. It's multifaceted. It's not just the music, it's of course the gear, like which bass do I want to play? Is it all going to be on the P bass tomorrow, for instance, with the nylon tape wound strings? Or is it going to be a little bit on the Federa P bass with the Jim Dunlop flats? Or will it be on my main Federa that you guys see me playing a lot if I'm going to do some chordal stuff? I kind of have no idea where the session's going to go. So I want to spend what little time I have. The session is tomorrow morning. Thankfully, they're coming here to my place, so I have all of my stuff that I could possibly use. And ironically, with all of that at my fingertips, I'll probably use the simplest setup possible. And that is a common thread throughout many, many recording sessions that I've done. I always do come very prepared and take a lot of gear. I take tons of basses, take tons of different pedals and just different things for different situations as they crop up. No two recording sessions are the same, ever. Even if you recorded the same song 5 times, there would be things you would find that would be slightly different about it. And I'm as prepared as I possibly can be for that. But the common thread through all of the sessions I've ever done is that I normally, for the most part, I would say 80% of the time, normally find something that works and end up sticking to that for the bulk of the session. If I'm playing on the whole album, for instance, if it's a record day, like a true record day, and I'm playing on the whole album, I've often found that it's the simplest thing and the most consistent thing that works. That has quite often been a Fender P bass, sometimes a Fender Jazz bass, but very rarely like a high-end boutique-y thing. And it's quite often been with flat wound strings or nylon tape wound strings, but not that kind of regular setup that I'm used to with my own music with the five-string Federa. So that's worth bearing in mind if you're the kind of person who has a ton of gear and does take it to sessions, or even if you're the kind of person who has just one bass, one P bass, for instance. If you are that person who has the one P bass, you're probably going to be totally fine. And it's so versatile. It has like two options, right? Tone this way and then tone that way. Bam, bam, one, two. Really, really simple. And it's the most consistent. It's the most recorded instrument. It's what engineers understand the most. It's what both mixing and recording and mastering. It is the workhorse as far as I'm concerned. And what my experience tells me, it's not just me with my opinion. It's actually my experience of going to the studio and making a lot of records over the course of my career and it being really the common thread throughout it. So if you're ever thinking like, okay, what do I need to do to go to the session? Yes, if you have the gear, take it. There are gonna be times where a five-string fretless is gonna be perfect for the verse of some song somewhere, absolutely. No doubt about it. And where the 62 P bass is gonna sound better than the 74 P bass, and all of these things. And there are minute differences between the instruments and with the gear, and where a certain compressor setting is gonna be different, or a preamp setting is gonna be different and create a different vibe. But the bulk of the work, it obviously is coming from the brain and the soul and the fingers, but the bulk of the work when it comes to the gear is normally for me being done on an instrument like this. So that's probably my biggest piece of advice when you're preparing for a record date is know your gear. Like, I really know this instrument, so know your gear. And I know this thing so much that I know it's going to work on, like I said, 80%+ of all the record dates I do. Now, there's not a lot of direction so far from Ryan as to exactly what he wants me to do, or the film crew, or what we're recording. I have, like I said, a ton of drum loops that he sent me to that we could possibly use. I don't think we're gonna get to all of them because I think it's gonna be quite a short kind of a promotional video for the Loop Loft. So I'm really kind of, I picked two things that I liked, and then of course there'll be a director and there'll be some other input, director producer situation going on. So I'll have to be ready for those things, but I really want to have something ready to go. I want to have something that if they say, okay, we have a time constraint, or do you have something prepared? I want to be able to say, yes, I've totally played along with these couple of loops. I feel most comfortable with them, and let's go and let's start there. That's obviously not always possible at a recording session. This is quite unique in the sense that I've been sent more material than we're actually going to record. Normally, I get called to play a song or three songs or a whole album, so it's pretty defined what I'm gonna record. This is a little looser, this is a little more open, and it's more about the video than it is the audio, because it's a kind of a promotional video thing. So these are all things to take into consideration, and when it comes down to it being more about the video and about the look, when you're looking at a video thing, it's just really good to be streamlined and prepared and kind of know what a director or a producer might be looking for. I always say that the music business, and now video business as well, is like 80-90%, well, it's like 10% music and maybe 90% dealing with people. So you have to read those people, you have to take on board the notes they give you and the direction they give you, and you have to put all that in a pot and figure it out and really give them back what hopefully you think they need and what they want. And that's a real art. You know, working in the studio isn't just being able to sight read really well or being able to play in time. It's a real art of managing the space, managing the people that are involved, managing the other musicians, and of course managing yourself and making sure you're not too overbearing or you're not sticking out too much, or you know, if you have suggestions that you're giving them at the right time and that they're appropriate. And if you really are just the bass player or just a side man on a session, then for the most part, it's really good advice to kind of keep your mouth shut and do your job, you know, unless somebody really comes over and say, hey man, what do you think about this? You know, rather than just after 8 bars stopping the session, being like, oh, I think we should be doing this and we'll put that over there. And why isn't there a ukulele player on this? You know, it's all about reading the situation. So I'm gonna look at this Nate Smith groove. I've listened to it, I haven't played to it yet, so I have no concept as of right this second as to what I might prepare for the session tomorrow. So you get to kind of see that in real time. I'm gonna listen to it. That's the most important thing, right? Oh, right off the bat, it just feels so good. Nate Smith's time and feel is smoking. Thank you. So immediately I'm kind of feeling out, because there's nobody else here. I'm just feeling out like where I fit into this mix here, where I fit into this situation, what I can get away with. This is a luxury that I'm not in the studio live with these musicians feeling out, okay, is this too much for a fill or is this too busy for a bass line? I'm doing this in like my own time, my own space, super relaxed. That's a real luxury to have. So I'm doing it and I'm playing, probably starting out playing a little too much and then dialing it back and taking notes out of the situation. That's kind of how I work when I'm practicing. So it really makes me aware of space and makes me aware of time and sound and kind of what's appropriate for the song. Now this is quite unique. There is no song. It's just a 4-bar drum loop and I'm adding some bass to it. But I'm thinking like it's a song. I'm feeling it like it's a song. Maybe this is a verse, for instance, and I'm kind of hearing a melody and I'm hearing a vocal. I'm hearing somebody sing something. Don't know what it's about yet, but that's kind of what's going on in my mind, even with nothing else there. No guitars, no keyboards, no vocals, no nothing. No producer in the room telling me what it should be. It's just my own brain producing what I think might be applicable and appropriate. And being totally okay for someone to come along and say, yeah, you know what, that's not it. That's not what we're looking for. We're looking for something more in another direction. And that other direction might be something I completely disagree with. But when I'm serving a song and when I'm working for a producer or working for an artist, that's my job. And we have to be really conscious of that and not, you know, not get in the way of ourselves, not get ourselves fired from the session. Okay, I'm getting somewhere, actually nowhere near where I want to be. I'm kind of hoping that when there are some other people in the room that I'm gonna be able to play off that. I find that a lot, you know, this is actually kind of hard. As much as I said earlier on, it's like a luxury that I get to experiment with these grooves and be completely relaxed in my own space. It's really nice to be able to play off other people, whether those people are in a speaking role and a directing or producing role, or whether those are the other musicians in the room. It's really great to be able to feed off that. And when you get a great group of musicians with big ears, that's when it gets really fun for me in the studio, creating songs, creating parts, serving the songs, and making, you know, making the artist and making everyone else in the room sound as good as they possibly can. That's always, always my first kind of stop. You know, my first thought is like, okay, how can I make everyone else sound better? You know, that's my job, is to help everyone else, like a, it's like a cooperative thing, and good to be able to dial all of those things in and put them in their place and monitor them and let loose a little bit sometimes. I'm not saying by any means be like totally stiff and just completely in the background. It's really just a huge balancing act that is totally unique, I think, on every session and on every song. And I think that's the most fun part of the studio for me, is that changes every single time. And no matter how much you think you know walking into a session, boy, you're gonna find out a lot more than you bargained for, I guarantee it. At least I always have on pretty much every session I've ever been on. So I'll leave you with that thought. We'll get to record some stuff for the new lesson site tomorrow. It is gonna be Janek's Bass Studio. I put the logo up on Instagram and everyone voted on it, and it's really coming together. Should be about a couple of weeks until it gets relaunched. All of the current members, if you are a current member of VideoBassLessons.tv or VBL, I will be migrating everyone to the new site. It will be totally seamless. It will just pop up and you'll be running on a whole new experience all of a sudden. I am so excited. I'm working like day and night on it and also trying to find a new house. And we have another house viewing tomorrow morning before this session. So it's a little bit crazy the next 2 weeks. And I'm glad you guys are along for the ride and are hanging in there with me on the vlog. And I can't wait to bring you along for this session tomorrow. We'll bring you along. It's gonna be right here. But I get to film with these guys. I'll get to have my camera while they're filming as well. So you'll get to see what happens and see really inside the process and see exactly the things I've been talking about today. You'll see them in action tomorrow. So today's vlog is done. We'll see you guys tomorrow.